If you're running low on seats, we have a few more, but we got space over here.
We also had a presentation about smoke in our region and the fact that usually forest fires create a lot more smoke and potentially more harmful smoke than prescribed burns, because prescribed burns are generally produce less smoke in our area. So what that means for our planning ahead. But tonight we're going to turn our focus over to the who's who of forests and fires. So we're going to invite some experts and local managers up for a panel discussion. We have five lovely speakers tonight. We're going to have Matt Genoviak from the United States Forest Service, Kent Grant from Colorado State Forest Service, Charlie Landsman from Firewise, Butch Knowlton from La Plata County Emergency Management, and Jimbo Yogarud from San Juan Citizens Alliance. But before we get there, we're gonna start a presentation with a presentation by Aaron Kimple, the Forest Health Program Director at Mountain Studies Institute. And he'll tell you a little bit about the conditions that we've seen this year, delve into a little bit of the details on that. And then Matt Tootin from San Juan National Forest will talk for a couple minutes as well, about 10 minutes about our local forest and his Forest Service perspective. And then we'll take a quick break again. You can, at that point, get some more beers, or feel free to do that whenever you want, whenever you need. There's also snacks up here. We, of course, always want to thank our sponsors that are up here. I'm from Mountain Studies Institute. I guess I never said that, right? My name is Laurel Sebastian, and I'm the Forest Health Education Coordinator. And we helped put this on along with San Juan Citizens Alliance and really input from all of these partners. The Powerhouse Science Center, of course, for supporting, helping us support the space, and you can help support them by drinking a little bit tonight, as well as the Forest Service and Firewise. And our principal sponsor and supporter for the night is the Colorado State Forest Service. On that note, I'm gonna pass around a couple of clipboards that just help them track attendance and their community outreach, and that just helps them with grants and all that. And it also helps us. If you want to get more information about this kind of event, we welcome you to sign up on the Mountain Studies Institute mailing list if you want at that back table. And we also have other resources from our sponsors in the back. That's about it. We're definitely excited about tonight. We will have speakers for about half an hour, but the principal point of this evening is to really hear from the community, hear your questions, what are your concerns, what do you need to know, what resources do you need to be connected with. So we're looking forward to that part, so get your questions ready. And without further ado, this is Aaron Kimple.
I don't know that I've heard a round of applause yet, Shane. We'll get my card from that. Start some information. I think Laurel deserves a big round of applause for pulling all this stuff together. She really kind of coordinated all this, and so I want to thank her. Woo! I am Aaron Kimble. I'm the program director for Forest Health at Mountain Studies Institute. I need this. And we are a research and education organization working in the San Juan Mountains. And we really pride ourselves in taking community-driven questions and helping to bring gather questions from local communities, build information that kind of answers that question, helps advance that the knowledge around that, and then the big part of that is bring that back to the community. This is really about bringing information so that communities can make educated decisions. And that's what tonight is about. That's what this whole series has been about. And we'll get into that a little bit. It's the questions that we've all had around just watching what's not happened this past winter. So, and this is where we work. And one of the things I love about this image is that here's our beloved San Juan Mountains, and just looking at all the other people, communities, states, ecosystems that rely on the waters that are derived from our snowpack in the mountains. So it's just something that we need to keep in mind. We think about our local community, but we're really very connected to much of the Southwest. But as I said, this event, these evenings, were really driven by questions when we were all sitting in January and trying to put on our fat skis and we couldn't, you know, they weren't worth putting off. Or we were just looking outside trying to get out and think about how we were going to play in the winter, and all we saw was it was dry, it was arid, and we weren't getting more snow. And really, you know, these conversations were happening at the kitchen tables. They were happening at our land manager tables. We're having these discussions. Business owners were having discussions around this. It's really this graph that drove a lot of, I think all of us have been a part of conversations looking at what is happening with our snowpack. This is more than snowpack. This is called the snowwater equivalent. So this measures basically the amount of water that's in the snow that's sitting on the top of the mountains, which is really a direct reflection of how much water we're going to get into our system. So it's more than just the snowpack. But for fun, we call it sweet. That's our sweet. And one of the reasons this was so relevant is because when you look here, and when we were asking ourselves these questions, this is 2017, the next year up was 2002. And for those of you who were around in 2002, you remember this. And that graph really brought back a lot of memories around 2002 and what our community experienced then. And this is the Missionary Ridge Fire. It was kind of when launched an era of big fires that we recognized. That was kind of in our memory, and not only was it a big fire, but it burned hot in a lot of places, and so there was really extensive ecological, very visible ecological damage. And the other thing we saw was runoff from that mud when the monsoons finally came. So how did we end up in this place where we were looking at a low snowpack, looking at a low sweep? We are in a La Nina year, and this image to me represents what our fall and probably till almost February looked like. And if you watched
the Weather Channel or anything like that. This is from the National Weather Service out of Boulder. We had this jet stream that was blocking anything but moisture from coming down to our region, and we were hot, warm, and dry. I was riding Phil's World in November, December. That's ridiculous. And then that persisted until about late winter, when we saw this pattern where we saw a little bit of moisture coming in, but nothing that was really registering heavily on in our region. But so we were still getting some blockage, but some weather precipitation coming into the area. And that's how we ended up with this graph. One thing to look at with this graph, like I said, so this is sort of it's more than just snowpack, it's the snow water that's sitting up there. This is 2002, and you can see where it started, that snowpack and that snow water equivalent started dropping out. We've just turned the corner. We're dropping out. And so, unless we get what they refer to in Dolores, which is the Miracle May, which happened right here in 2016, we're just going to drop down that slide. I can't figure this microphone out. We were looking at a fairly dry year, below average in 2016, and we turned a corner. A rare corner, and got a bunch of snowpack. I can't predict the future, but I think we'll probably look more like this regular decline going on. I stacked a couple of other years onto this graph just to kind of put our years in context. And so 2002 year, the bluer lines are the years that happened 3 years prior to 2002. And I don't know that it tells much of a story. One of the things that we can keep in mind is that with the past couple of years, we do have full reservoirs that we didn't have in 2002. There was a lot of water storage that's been accumulated. Reservoirs were about half full in 2002 as compared to this year. We're full. So this is an interesting graph. This relates to a little bit of where we're sitting as far as our runoff goes. This is 100 years of river flow in the Animas River. And so from between 1912 to 2017. The red line, that's us, 2017. This is, 2002 is the yellow line, and 1977 was also a historically low year, as was 1990. This year, 2017, we've registered some of the lowest flows in the Animas River recorded. I guess I really like that graph. We extended it over just to show that, you know, things change. We get different precipitation at different times, so when we look at where we currently are, we have to keep in mind that we're in our fourth month. We have 8 more months. But looking at this year and where we stand in March and April, and look where things start to level out, is right about now. Typically, our very dry time is in this June era, or June month, until we get to this July, August. And that's when our monsoons start kicking in. So I can't predict what's going to happen in the next few months. And we're just looking at trends. But we definitely need a turn of events here to help us with our moisture. This puts this year in context. When you start looking at kind of where we stand and you look at the trends, we've seen an increase in temperatures for our area of 2 degrees. This is measured changes in our specific area from 1993 to 2012. and that was an increase of 2 degrees. We've also seen our snow line rise in elevation about 621 feet. So that's about, you know, Durango, you know, snow line. You know, my house is about 1,000 feet higher. We'd be right snow line. Durango would have gotten a little bit more snow historically. So we've seen that increase. One thing to keep in mind is the grass, the pretty grass I showed you with the sweep. That's for very high elevation snowmelt sites. They're up on Red Mountain Pass. That does not register these lower elevation snowmelts. And that is a lot more grim. And we just haven't seen a huge snowpack down low. And the other thing that we have seen increase is our spring runoff has come back 2 weeks. So it says plus 2 weeks, that means it's occurred 2 weeks earlier than it has historically. And so we've just been seeing that with the increase in temperatures, snow, and some of our dust events, we're seeing runoff happen earlier. And that brings us to tonight, which is really about what can we do about this? And this is where we start. And with the conversation we'll have up here with the panel, we're really, it's that community. It's bringing the community together to start thinking about how do we contend with these changes that we're faced with as far as our precipitation goes and how we live within this community and the ecosystem that we've all opted to live in. So that is the information that I have, just to sort of set the stage. And then Matt is going to talk a little bit about how this reflects on the forests in our area and how it might translate to that. Right?
Do you have any questions specifically for Aaron right now? We'll obviously have lots more time for questions as well.
Yeah, Rob.
2 weeks earlier on that snowball about Buddy.
I don't have information on Buddy. I wish I could speak to that. Yeah.
How is the snow
line? It is interesting, and it's and I would need to follow up on the specifics of how they calculated that. But we do have snowtell sites that kind of, we have some sites that measure down low. We don't have many that hit in a low elevation, which is sort of the big gap in our information. We need more sites monitoring low elevation snowpack. So anyway, I would need to dig into that a little bit more. Okay. Great.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Matt Tutin. I'm a forester on San Juan National Forest on the Pagosa and Columbine Ranger Districts. So my job is to manage forests from essentially Wolf Creek Pass to just a little bit west of Durango, so a big area. And I'm going to try to provide a little bit of context for some of the climate info that Aaron presented just a few minutes ago, and just a little bit of context for discussions tonight. So. Essentially what I'm going to cover here, there we go. All right, so just a quick overview. I'm going to do a little quick overview of the major forest types that we have here in San Juan, because as you're probably all aware, the forest types around Durango are a little bit different than they are up around Silverton. We're going to go over that. Do a little bit of the big picture on our current conditions out there on the ground. Not get too into the details on that, just kind of provide some context. Talk about some of the big change agents that are changing our forests. I'm sure most folks who live here are aware our forests are changing dramatically in some cases due to lots of different forest health threats. And then just kind of end up with what to expect this coming season given the fact that we're pretty dry here, as Aaron just discussed. So up here we have a little schematic of just sort of how our vegetation is assembled out on the landscape. Tends to be really elevationally driven, as I think everybody knows. But as we start off at the very lowest elevations, we're pretty much in our juniper forest. Now, I'm not going to really talk about that a whole lot. I kind of call it a woodland. Don't manage a lot of it. But that's probably a lot of what we have around Durango. But our first real forest type is our ponderosa pine, mixed with gamble oak. You all see it mixed with juniper around here. So I think everybody's aware this is our fire-adapted forest type. Historically, we had these frequent fires that kept these forests open. But we put fires out last 100 years, they've grown up denser. And as a result, we have bigger and bigger fires like the Missionary Ridge type that folks are well acquainted with live around here. Going up in elevation, and this would be like a drive up to a ski area. So if you're going up to Purgatory, you're going up to Wolf Creek, you go through this mixed conifer and aspen zone. This is a great forest on San Juan. It's probably one of the most productive forest types in the whole state or in the Southwest. In these forests, it's a lot wetter. In general, at the lowest elevations, it's kind of a lot like the ponderosa pine. It used to have really frequent fires. But as you get into the wetter parts of this forest, it becomes pretty infrequent fires historically because it was just too wet to burn. And so as a result, the fires were variable frequency. They sometimes were mixed severities, so meaning like sometimes a lot of trees died in big patches, sometimes it just burned in the understory, didn't kill a lot of trees at all. And the frequency could be anywhere from a couple years to 100 or more years. But as you get to the highest elevations, and this is sort of our ski area elevations, these are spruce fir forests. These are cold, wet places where fire really isn't a huge driver for the most part. So these forests are usually too wet to burn almost all the time. So fires are really infrequent. But when they do burn, which tends to be in the driest years, they can be pretty severe. So think of West Fork Fire over Pagosa. That was a spruce fir forest burning in really hot, dry conditions. So just to look at how that's kind of spread out amongst the San Juan National Forest, that sort of teal color, that's your spruce fir, that's at your highest elevations. And that's in the wilderness, so you can kind of see, oops. All right, well, oh, there we go. So basically the tops of the mountains are spruce fir before you get to tree line. And then your places like Hermosa Canyon, the Cager area, that's where you get a lot of this mixed conifer. And then we're kind of just on the edge of the ponderosa pine zone down in our cities, where we had more frequent fire. So to talk about the conditions we have out there, one of the things that really characterizes our part of the world, mainly due to a lot of the fire suppression, is this continuous forest canopy. By putting out a lot of these fires over the last century, we have a lot of canopy continuity. You don't have a lot of spaces between trees. And I say mostly up here because we have a couple big holes in this canopy, i.e. the Missionary Ridge Fire. The Narragansett Fire, the West Fork Fire, so some big, severe fires that put some holes in our forests. And so this creates shady conditions that are really ripe for the establishment of a shade-tolerant understory. And so in our mixed conifer forests, we have trees like white fir, Douglas fir, blue spruce that do really well establishing the understory trees. At the wettest elevations, that's pretty natural. In our more fire-adapted forests, this can form a shade-tolerant lava fuel that can really lead to establishment of crown fires. So that's something we're seeing almost everywhere we go in our mixed conifer forests. Those trees tend to be really susceptible to something we see out there in the ground, which is western spruce budworm. So that's a native moth that lays its eggs in canopies of trees, and little caterpillars eat the tops of the trees, and then they drop down, turn into moths, and the cycle repeats. These insects tend to do really well in forests where we have lots of ladder fuels, and so as a result, if you're out on the ground, you'll see lots of fir trees, lots of spruce trees that look like this, that look like they've been sort of flea bitten a little bit, which tends to weaken the trees and lead to some of the other things we're seeing. So bark beetles. So every tree that we have, conifer tree in our forest that we have, has a beetle that's adapted to it, one that's basically evolved with that tree. So these beetles get in the tree bark, They eat the cameo of the tree, they girdle it, leads to the death of the tree. So when the trees are stressed, either they've been eaten by a spruce budworm in the canopy, or they're also trying to survive in drought conditions. That makes them more susceptible to bark beetles. And so the big one we've seen around here is the spruce beetle. This really hit hard over on the eastern side of the forest. In areas around Wolf Creek, we saw up to 90% of trees, 95% of trees over 10 inches have died from this bark beetle. This sort of population of beetles has been moving west over the last 10 years or so, and we're definitely seeing it on the Columbine District down the Beaver Meadows Road. So if this beetle ends up moving into the Highway 550 corridor in mass, we could see some big changes in our spruce forest up at around Silverton Purgatory, that area. Another big change happening is that we're seeing round-headed western and mountain pine beetles in our ponderosa pine forest on the Dolores side of the forest, so on our far western side of the forest. So these are beetles that kill ponderosa pine trees. They kind of build these little population centers that sort of build out in bigger and bigger patches. We've seen big increases in this over the last couple of years. Here's a map of an area just north of Dolores. So right now this is at the scale of hundreds to thousands of acres. So not quite your 10,000 plus like we're seeing with spruce beetle, but we're also having a really big drought here this year. So we could see some big changes to this, and I think Kent could be a good source of information on this because he's worked a lot on this issue, Kent Grant, with the state. So definitely something to keep in mind. Another one we're seeing is the Douglas fir beetle. This is sort of your lesser known bark beetle. A lot of folks don't know a whole lot about the fir because you don't really see whole stands of Douglas fir, but these tend to be our biggest and very oldest trees in the forest. We have some of the largest specimens of inland Douglas fir in the world. And what this beetle does is it preferentially kills the oldest and largest trees, unfortunately, and it moves kind of slowly through the landscape. And so if you're driving up the pass and you see some bright orange trees, what you're probably looking at is Douglas fir sort of flaming out and dying from the Douglas fir beetle. So this will be something that we're going to watch this year and see how this changes. So, not necessarily the most inspiring story, but what to expect in 18, we're probably going to see more standing dead trees. Some of them are going to die from some of the bark beetles and some of the spruce budworm defoliation that I was talking about. Because we have such a dry year, we're probably going to see increased potential for large and severe fires, so fires that kill lots of trees. And this could potentially be the case in our wetter types that don't usually see fire. So this is kind of the year where those types that don't see fire very frequently could actually see some fire. But again, if it rains all May, then maybe this doesn't happen. So too soon to tell. And last, we'll probably see some land management activities to address some of this. I think there's a growing awareness that managing fires is a way to deal with some of these canopy continuity issues, so we'll probably be doing some of that. Some prescribed fire in the Columbine District, and then some salvage harvest and some thinning in our lower elevation forests. So we'll be doing some things in the national forest. We may see some log trucks, we may see some equipment out in the woods, try to address some of these issues in designated areas. So I don't want to leave you with just that story. So here's kind of the bright side of all this. So the San Juan National Forest, like I said, is one of the most productive forests in the Southwest, and we have lots of tree species and diversity. So we're going to be in a better spot here than in other places in the state. We don't just have one forest of lodgepole pine trees that all dies and you don't have anything else growing. We've got lots of different tree species. And we're dealing with native pests. So these aren't pests from Asia, these aren't pests from Europe, these are pests that the trees are adapted to. So we do have some resiliency built into our system. We have this continued potential to manage fires, and I think, like I said, growing awareness that this is going to help solve some of our problems. And every time we manage a fire, that's a big fuel stream that addresses some of these issues. So fire is, in a way, a big solution to some of these problems. And then aspen. Aspen's going to be a big winner out there. What's bad for the conifers is great for aspen. Most of our mixed conifer forest has some aspen, sort of suppressing the understory, and when the conifers die, aspen takes off. So that's a great thing we've got going on here. And then last, a little pitch for forest products. Dead spruce, dead Douglas fir, dead ponderosa pine. They make nice forest products, local forest products. You can actually buy blue stain pine that's off of the San Juan National Forest. So some local entrepreneurs kind of making some use of some of these products. So there's kind of a silver lining. You can have a little piece of the southern San Juan Forest in your house if you really want to. So with that, I'll take some questions. We can kind of move on, and I look forward to the discussion. We were saying, some of us earlier, that it's great to be able to have a session where we kind of dig into some of the science issues, because it's really what got me into this field. So I appreciate everybody coming out. This is great. Most of our spruce fir tends to be in the wilderness, so initially we didn't have a huge push for salvage. But to that point, in the last couple of years, we've really ramped up our efforts, and so there's actually two active contracts for salvage of dead trees off of Wolf Creek Pass. And so some of those dead spruce are going to be cut, hauled to Sawatch, Colorado, and they're going to be milled into logs for log homes and for timber frame homes. So different market, not going to Montrose. A lot of the stuff on the other side of the mountains, like you noticed, is actually going directly to that mill. But you know, additionally, this year we're also going to offer a sale of dead spruce that could go to Montrose. So Montrose is interested. They're interested in the beetle kill as it occurs on our forests in operable areas. And so they may be interested in doing some of that logging over here. But we're a little bit behind the sort of the schedule that the GMA or the Grammy Sun Talking Guts comes on. So good observation.
Yeah, good. I've heard varying reports about whether beetle kill trees are actually more susceptible to fire or not. Could you speak on that?
amongst folks in the know on that, it's a touchy issue, or should say touchy, controversial. You get into a lot of complexity on the subject. So there's generally accepted that there's a sort of a time period when the tree dies, but it hasn't lost its needles, that flammability really increases, right? Because you have all these dead, dry needles on a tree. And so when fire hits a tree like that, it just bursts into flames. But when that tree drops all its needles and all the fine branches fall off because of weathering, then it kind of loses its receptivity to embers and to fires. And so it's generally accepted that the fire hazard decreases in a certain amount of time after the trees die. But then another thing happens after all the trees die is that now you don't have any canopy kind of shading the ground. So now you kind of increase the understory of that forest to the sun and to heating and to drying. And so there could be another kind of pulse down the road after that. And then, you know, potentially even more severity as those trees fall down and create kind of a jack straw fuel situation. That latter part isn't necessarily completely ironed out, and so there's a little bit of uncertainty of whether or not that's true. But in general, at least initially, following a beetle kill event, when there's still needles on the tree, definitely an increase in fire severity. But as you get into that one, what seems like a pretty simple question becomes kind of complicated, so you can do a PhD on it.
I noticed the junipers about 7,000 feet, they grow well, are kind of brown, they're a little off color. Has this happened before, and are they going to be all right?
That's another one of these head scratchers. There was some emails going around amongst land managers about why are the junipers turning brown, and I'm not sure if we ever resolved it. I think we the sort of consensus was that it was just needle cast and that they'll probably just come back just fine. But when you manage natural systems, sometimes you're surprised. You're often surprised. And so generally, we don't think that there's any negative effects from this needle cast that we're seeing. But we're basically monitoring it. We're going to see how it proceeds. But the general consensus, we're in the clear. The junipers are probably fine. And it's a pretty prolific and resilient species, resistant species to drought. It's spread all around by birds, and so I don't think we're ever going to really lose our junipers out of our forest. So stay tuned, though, because we could be wrong. It is a very small percentage. I don't have the figure. Oh, sorry. So what is the capacity to salvage dead trees on this side of the forest? And I suppose there's two parts. So first, we only have capacity to salvage harvest areas that we stated in our forest plan we would allow that activity. And so we're actually not going to go into wilderness and salvage trees and logging equipment. Rob and I go into really steep terrain where it'd be cost prohibitive. So we're limited on that end because of our sort of land makeup. And so what percentage that is, I can't say, but it's fairly small percentage of the spruce fir zone. Where we will be salvaging are where we have roads and where we set in our forest plan that we wanted to manage for forest products. The other component of this is that there's a limited capacity for industry to really go into some of these places. And in the process of offering up some of this material for sale, through timber sale contracts and stewardship contracts, what we're finding out is the capacity of the industry. And I suppose the lesson for me in this business is that there's much more capacity and diversity in this industry than maybe we initially assumed. We haven't had a sale go no bid yet, so every sale we've put out has had bidders on it. Purchase, but at a certain point we may hit sort of a peak and we may have sales not sell. But at this point, everything that we sold is selling, and so we're continuing to sell dead trees in places where we have operable ground, in areas where we're administratively able to sell trees. So that's my shot at that one.
You mentioned what's bad for the devil's fur is with the aspect of the
club. Yeah, bad for conifers.
Conifers. What about the aspect of the trees that's affecting them, the sap, or is drought making that worse?
Yeah, it's a very.
Second.
Yeah, so let me just say that one. So, is the are the conditions that are leading to the decline of some of the conifers going to also lead to the decline of the aspen? At this point, this sudden aspen decline, which we've heard about over the last 10 years or so, has been sort of correlated with the drought conditions over the last 10, 15 years. So there is the potential for decline of aspen due to some of those same factors, but it's probably going to be in some of the sort of the fringe areas for that species. So I mean, if you have aspen growing in a place where it's really tough for aspen to grow, that tends to be where you see some of these aspen decline issues. Generally, we have pretty productive places on this forest with lots of soil, and so I think we're going to see lots of aspen resprout in some of those areas. Now, the long-term prognosis for those sprouting or aspen might not be great, but getting them established is kind of the first step towards getting a forest. So at least initially, we're going to at least see aspen established, and then we'll just have to monitor that. Good question.
We're thinking of taking a break. I don't know if you have maybe one more question and then we'll move on.
All right, yeah, go ahead. Yeah, you can ask the family questions, but maybe one more.
Besides fire cattle grazing, has modified course. So, what plans are there for monitoring that as far as reproduction?
it's monitoring reproduction of trees.
Right. Yeah, I mean, you say the aspens will come up, but a lot of the areas that are open for grazing uses, everything gets browsed out.
Yeah, and so anywhere where we're actively managing forest vegetation with harvest, we'll be taking a really close look at those factors. So if we go in and salvage harvest, we have requirements under the law to make sure that we meet minimum stocking standards post-harvest. Now, when you talk about the broader landscape, there could be places, there may be places that are below those standards, but due to a range of different factors, if it's being understood as a range management issue, then we have folks in the forest that really assess whether or not cattle impacts are impacting vegetation and keeping us from meeting those standards. I wouldn't be the one to really necessarily address that, but if you do have concerns on that, definitely bring them up and point them out, and we can relay that to folks in the forest that manage cattle and livestock grazing in the forest. So there's undoubtedly things that we don't know that, you know, we rely on the public to kind of key us in on. So please let us know if it's something we don't. All good? All right, thank you guys.
So we'll have a whole other hour for questions, so definitely don't forget them, and we'll be back with that. We're going to take a 10 to 15 minute break, get some snacks, some refreshments. I wanted to point out two things, though. You'll probably see I put them on every other chair, not really knowing how many people would be here or not, but we have a bunch more in the back if you need some. We have surveys, and that's just because we'd really love to hear your feedback from tonight. This is a big goal of tonight, is just to hear from the community, hear your concerns, hear what questions are unanswered and what resources you need. So we'd really appreciate you filling that out. And then I didn't explain the sign-in super well. Colorado State Forest Service can use that for in-kind grant matching, so it really helps them leverage funding. It's actually not for you to sign up for a mailing list, so we're just trying to get a tally of who's here tonight, and if you just put your name down, that's really helpful. If you do want to sign up for an email list, you could talk to the Colorado State Forest Service. Also, I'm sure San Juan Citizens Alliance, everyone here has one. Mountain Studies Institute definitely has one in the back. And with that, we will take a break and be back with some new speakers. But yeah, 10-15 minutes.